Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. My name is Reverend Lisa Michelle Little, and I am an associate minister at St. John's AME Church in Norfolk, Virginia, under the anointed leadership of Pastor Vernon Leon Rick Sr. And it is my privilege and my honor today to bring a word to you that I hope will help you in your journey, wherever you might be in that journey for such a time as this. So let's start by reading the Word of God. Today it will come from Matthew, the 26th chapter, verses 36 through 47. And Matthew 26, beginning at 36, reads as follows. It says, "Then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and saith unto his disciples, Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy." How many of you know that he was experiencing depression? Sorrowful and very heavy. Verse 38 says, "Then saith he unto them, My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me. And he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto them, Peter, what? Could ye not watch with me just 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And he went away again the second time and prayed, saying, O my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it, thy will be done. And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. And he left them and went away again and prayed the third time, saying the same words. Then he cometh to his disciples and saith unto them, Sleep on now and take your rest. Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of the sinners. Rise, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. And while he yet spake, lo, Judas, one of the 12, came, and with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and the elders of the people." Amen. Today, I want to talk to you about getting through Gethsemane. That's the topic of our message today. It's getting through Gethsemane. And if you don't know what Gethsemane is, symbolically, Gethsemane for Jesus represented coming to a place in his life's journey where his life began to look bleak. As Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he knew that he was about to die. Gethsemane for Jesus also meant experiencing hardship that seemed more than he could bear. How many of you know that just as we are human, Jesus was human? And for him, Gethsemane put him in a place where he thought he had more than he could bear to deal with. Because not only was he going to die, but Jesus knew that he was about to be arrested for a crime he did not commit. He knew that he would not get a fair trial and that he would be convicted again for a crime he did not commit. And he knew that he was going to get the death penalty. And in his day and time, death penalty meant literally being nailed to a cross. And so no wonder Jesus was sorrowful. No wonder he was experiencing depression, because the future looked bleak. And it looked like more than anybody could humanly bear. And not only that, for Jesus, Gethsemane meant finding himself in a position where there was no one on earth that he could turn to who could or would help him. He did try to reach out to his disciples in that garden. He asked them to watch and to pray on his behalf. And instead, they went asleep. They dropped the ball on Jesus. And I think all of us know what it's like to be in your darkest moment, your most difficult time, and you reach out for help. and all of the people that you've always helped let you down. You've been there for them through thick and thin, and yet when you need them most, you can't count on them even to say a word of prayer to you. How many of you know that Gethsemane represented a rough place and a rough time for Jesus? And if we live long enough, all of us will reach the point where we will experience a Gethsemane situation in our lives. And while my Gethsemane might be different from your Gethsemane, we will have a Gethsemane experience. See, for some people, the Gethsemane experience may be that they've received a bad report from the doctor. For someone else, it might mean that they received a bad report from the bill collectors. For one person, it may mean that they're dealing with a wayward child. And for another one, it might mean the loss of a job. For one person, it might mean the death of a loved one. And for somebody else, it might mean the end of a marriage. But we will all have a Gethsemane experience if we live long enough. If Jesus was perfect and he had a Gethsemane experience, we can expect to find ourselves in a Gethsemane place also. But there is good news today for somebody. No matter how bad your Gethsemane experience is, you can get through it. And there is a way out. And my assignment today is to share with you three things that will help you to get through your Gethsemane experience. And the first thing I want to say about the Gethsemane experience is that if you're going to get through it, you have to keep talking to God. How many of you know that you have to keep talking to God? When Jesus was in his Gethsemane experience, he went into prayer. In fact, he prayed to the Lord three times. And I want somebody to get that. Praying one time is not enough just to get you through the Gethsemane experience. Prayer has to be a routine. It has to be a pattern. It has to be something that you do regularly. It has to be something that you do over and over. One time won't just get it for you. And you have to keep praying even when God doesn't answer back. Jesus continued to pray, although God never answered him. And I know somebody is saying, what good is that to pray to a God who doesn't answer you in the time of need? But how many of you know that prayer is not just about getting what you want from God, but more important, it's about being connected with God and staying connected with God. Because anytime you are connected with God, you are guaranteed the victory in whatever situation you're dealing with. And while God might be silent and while he might not tell you the path that will take you to victory, if you are connected with him, then you have victory. That's how your story will end. It's just like someone who is a professional athlete. They understand that when they go into the football game, that they might lose the first quarter, the second quarter, the third quarter, and they might even start out losing the fourth quarter. But it really doesn't matter how many times you're experiencing a losing streak. It matters how you end. And when you're connected to Jesus, you end well. But the problem that some people have is that instead of talking to God when they're going through a struggle, going through a Gethsemane situation, they get mad with God. They get so disappointed, so upset, even so depressed that they stop talking to him. But I want to encourage somebody today to just keep talking to God, because when you have a little talk with Jesus, it does make things right. Amen, somebody. And the second thing I want to share with you about getting through a Gethsemane situation is that if you're going to get through it, you might as well make the most of it. And I know somebody's asking, well, how do I do that? While you're in your Gethsemane situation, that's a good time to take your misfortune and turn it into a ministry. Let me say that again, somebody. When you're going through a Gethsemane situation, that's the time to take your misfortune and turn it into a ministry. And that's another way of saying, use your pain and your hardship to learn some lessons that will help someone else. This is exactly what Jesus did. He knew that he was getting ready to go to the cross. He knew that he was getting ready to die. His disciples had let him down, and he even had one disciple who was in the midst of betraying him. But when Jesus talked to his disciples in that garden, one of the things that he told them is that to watch and to pray and not yield to temptation, because the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. That was the life lesson that Jesus learned in his own Gethsemane experience. He learned that there's always a battle between the spirit and the flesh. And while the spirit wants to do right, the flesh will try to cause you to do wrong. And all too often, brothers and sisters, the flesh does win. And so during that time, while he was going through his greatest struggle, he still took a moment to teach his disciples. He was having a Bible study, and it was about how the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He took his misfortune and he turned it into ministry. And I'm sure that later, after he had ascended into heaven, after the resurrection, I'm sure his disciples remembered that lesson at times, that there's always a battle between the spirit and the flesh, and we have to decide who will win. Will we allow our spirit to win or our flesh to win? But I encourage you, again, take your misfortune and turn it into a ministry. That's how we ended up with Mothers Against Drunk Driving, because there were some mothers who lost some children or had children who were injured at the hand of drunk drivers. And they decided to turn it into a movement that would minister healing to others like them. Many of our books in the Bible were written by Paul. And Paul was an apostle of Jesus Christ. And some of those books were written while he was in jail. Like Jesus, he didn't get a fair trial. He was convicted, although he was an innocent man. And he could have been a victim and felt sorry for himself. But instead, he redeemed the time and he began to write books that ended up in the Bible that bless us today. And I want to encourage somebody who has a book inside of them to start writing while we are on shutdown during the coronavirus. Take your miserable situation, take your misfortune, your mishap, and turn that into ministry for someone else. One other example of that is John Walsh. He is the father of Adam Walsh. Adam Walsh was a young boy who was kidnapped and he was murdered. And his father, as a result of that, is responsible for America's Most Wanted show. He's responsible for many young people who have been kidnapped being found, and some while they are still alive. And that's because he took his misfortune and he turned it into a ministry. And the last thing that I want to say about getting through your Gethsemane experience is that you have to see your experience through God's eyes. You have to see your experience through God's eyes. At the beginning of the Gethsemane situation, Jesus is seeing his situation through the eyes of his flesh. And what he's doing is he's asking the Lord to let this cup pass. In other words, he's saying, Jesus, Lord, I don't want to, Father God, I don't want to go to the cross and experience all of that pain and even to die for the sins of your people. Lord, let there be another way. Lord, let me get out of this somehow. But after he continues to pray, by the end of that, he's coming back to his disciples and he's saying, the hour is at hand. In other words, he's saying, now is the time. Let's get to it. Let's do it. And that's what prayer will do for you. It will give you the strength to press your way through a Gethsemane experience and get to the end and see what the end will be. And so we see Jesus having a different point of view because he began to look at it through God's eyes. And God never answered him, because what God really wanted him to realize is that you've got to do this, you know, and you have to do it for the good of the whole. No one would be able to go to heaven had Jesus not done this. Jesus had done a lot of good works up to that point. He had healed people. He had delivered people from their demons. He had taught the people. He had performed miracles. He prayed for the people, but he had not yet saved the people. And that's the divine perspective that he needed of his situation, was that if he did not go to that cross, nobody would go to heaven. And we all would go exactly where we deserve to be, which is not heaven. But because Jesus pressed his way through the Gethsemane experience and saw the situation the way God saw the situation, we can all go to heaven and have a right to the tree of life. That concludes my message today. And I do hope that you have been encouraged. And if you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, it's very easy. All you have to do is say, Jesus, I thank you that you died for my sins. I believe that you paid the penalty for my sins, and that because of what you've done, I can go to heaven and have my name written on the roll for heaven. And you just thank God. You praise him for that. That's all you have to do. Let us have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of the listeners. We know that somebody is going through a Gethsemane experience, oh Father God. We know that some have lost jobs. We know that some are at risk and in the line of fire, Lord God, as they serve those who have the coronavirus, oh Father God. We know that some have financial problems. Some don't know how they will eat. And Lord, some are struggling with having to work in a different way that requires them to be at home in isolation. But most of all, Lord, we thank you that you are with us and you are still good and you have a good plan for us. So Lord God, just help all of us to get through Gethsemane by walking with you, talking with you, and holding to your unchanging hand. In Jesus' name, amen.